Ah, praise the Lord. Praise Jesus. Praise the Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is come in the flesh. Awesome. Oh, man, I've had some amazing, amazing past 3 days. If you've been watching the deliverance videos, I mentioned that I needed more deliverance myself, and I got it. Called up my partner, came right over the same day. I had maybe 4 or 5 more princes just in my heart. And before this, I remember lying in bed, and I felt that my heart was a cup, and I just felt it physically fill up with hatred just while I was sleeping there. I rebuked it, but because I wasn't delivered until 2 days ago, I really still had a hard time with the heart, being angry and rageful and all that stuff. So I got delivered. I am happy because Satan still needs to have another tactic to get to me because keep on chopping away his attacks, and so he has to come at me with a new strategy. So all these princes all were in my heart. So, and those for you, trust your heart. Oh, well, the heart doesn't, you know, in my heart I don't feel this, in my heart I feel that. Well, Jeremiah says that the heart is deceitful. Who can know it? And put the scripture right there. Oh, praise the Lord. So I got delivered. David Hogan, amazing Mexican missionary, came up to my little tiny church and preached for 2 nights. And if you haven't heard of David Hogan, I wish I can be you because I would want to discover him all over again. That guy is amazing. I got a chance to look in his eyes and give him a hug and talk to him. And that guy is the real deal. And just listen to him and his stories of miracles and, man, just increases your faith. Please do not allow Satan to tell you that David Hogan is a false guy or whatever. Even if he is, even if he's just an actor and just out to get your money, which he's not, I don't believe he is. But even if he is still who we need to look like. All right. He is still doing the things of the Father. And based on this movie title, he is violent. He is a violent man. And I love him. I love him. Our battle is not against flesh and blood. Our battle is against the spiritual. We need to be violent in the spiritual realm. Matthew 11:12. From the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. If you get somebody saved, that's a violent act. You have pulled that person from the kingdom of hell. Fire is on their clothes. The smell of brimstone is in their hair. You have pulled them from hell and you have placed them in the kingdom of God. Does the devil want you to do that? Nope. Every time you speak truth, every time you speak love, does the devil want you to do that? Nope. That is a violent act. Praying for the lost, healing the sick, raising the dead, blind eyes open, deaf ears open, lame walk, that is violent acts. All right? Christians, let's be violent. Amen. To my pre, mid-trib, post-trib, pre-wrath guys, I love you. If I'm a pre-tribber, will you post-tribbers, will you stand beside me and will you be violent with me? Will you help me harvest the field if I'm a pre-tribber and you're a post-tribber? Will you do that? Will you stand with me? Pre-tribbers, if I'm a post-tribber, will you stand with me? Will you? Mid-trib, will you pre-wrathers, will you stand next to me and fight the devil with me, alongside me? I will raise you up and I ask you to raise me up. Will you do that? Will you be my friend? Will you be my Christian brother? Will you stab me in the back? To be quite honest, you rapture folk, I don't care. I love the thought about escaping this world and being with my Savior. Oh, that's awesome. But guess what? When I woke up this morning, my butt is on this earth. Do you know what that means? I have a job to do. You have a job to do. Let's harvest. Let's harvest those souls. Let's be violent. Let's heal the sick. Let's raise the dead. Let's be violent. If you don't know how to raise the dead or heal the sick, Proverbs 25:2, it is the glory of God to conceal a thing, but the honor of kings is to search out a matter. Your pastor, your friends, your family don't know how to heal the sick or raise the dead. So you make a theology which allows you to sleep good at night. Please don't do that. please read the Bible like a little child, because my Bible tells me I have authority over demons. I have authority over sickness. We can raise the dead through the power of Jesus Christ and the power of the cross. We can. And it is to the honor of kings to search out a matter. We need to swallow our pride. We need to humble ourselves like little children. And we need to try. We need to practice. I don't care if you lay hands on 1,000 people and they get worse. That 1,001 person that gets healed will flip you upside down. I guarantee it. Ask the Lord to increase your faith. How do we increase our faith? By knowing the Word of God. So if you have a theology that doesn't even allow you to try, that's a demonic theology. Because it's up to kings to search out a matter. And I want you to be a king. I pray to God that I'm a king. And I will try. I will swallow my pride. If I look foolish in front of man, I don't care. Because I honor my king. My king told me to lay hands on the sick. He did. So my choice is to please my king, not men. If I look like a fool, so be it. How else am I going to find out the matter if I don't try? How else are you going to find out the matter if you don't try? Pre-trib, mid-trib, pre-wrath, post-trib. Can we still be brothers? Because my eschatology views are different than yours, can we still be brothers? Can we still do the job that God has given us? Can we still be violent together? Can we take back the lost? Can we raise people from the dead? Can we heal the blind? Can we do it? Will we be together? If I fall, will you pick me up? I pray the Lord that you can. To be quite honest, all you guys are smart. There's some amazing scriptures on every side of the aisle. Every side. To my pre-tribbers, let me ask you this. Think carefully. In Hebrews 11:35, it's talking about the faith of those who passed before us. And it talks about, and others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they might obtain a better resurrection. A better resurrection. Forever is a long time. Forever is a long, long time. So, I just shared you a scripture about Matthew 11:12 about the violent. Let's go back one to 11:11. He that is least in heaven is greater than John the Baptist. He that is least in heaven is greater than John the Baptist. Matthew 5:19, teach and follow the commandments. Those who do will be great in heaven. Matthew 18:4, if you humble yourself as a little child, the same is greatest in the kingdom of heaven. If you want to be first, you need to become last. If you want to become great in the kingdom of God, you need to become servant of all. What about the parable of the pounds? King gave 1 pound to each servant. Invest as you see fit. Comes back. Hey, you're 1 pound, I have 10. You're in charge of 10 cities. You're 1 pound, I got you 5. You're in charge of 5 cities. You're 1 pound because I feared you, I hid it. Here's your 1 pound back. Well, you're evil. I'm going to take your 1 pound and I'm going to give it to the guy who has 10. Does that seem like when we get to heaven, everybody gets the same thing? It doesn't to me. If the least is greater than John the Baptist, and that means that there's great in heaven, and that there's least in heaven, and that there's all in between. And I believe, based on Revelation, that those who are great will become a pillar in the temple. Meaning, you will become closer, maybe your mansion or your dwelling, I don't know what, but you will be able to get closer to God than others. And that is a reward. So this is forever. If you want to be a rock star here on earth, well, most likely you're probably going to hell, but you're going to be least in the kingdom of heaven. If you want to be a servant and wash people's feet and be violent for the kingdom, then you're going to be great in the kingdom of heaven. And that is eternity. To my pre-tribbers, so let me ask you again. Will you stay with me? Will you be left behind when everybody else gets raptured? Will you ask God to leave you behind so we can go out and save those who are left behind? Granted, I'm not even sure if God will allow us to do that. Obviously, I want the power of the gospel if I'm going to be left behind, because I need to show the power of the gospel to those who are left behind, because there's going to be great deception. But I will rather be on this earth in utter hell for 2, 3, 4, 7 years and get my head chopped off and get a better resurrection forever. Forever is a long time. Even if I was tortured for 6 months every single day, 24 hours a day, when I get to heaven, every tear will be wiped away. I will not remember. But I, you know what I will remember is I will be great in heaven forever. So pre-tribbers, will you ask to stay, stand beside me, and fight with me for a chance to obtain a better resurrection? Will you do that? Doesn't it make sense to go through 3 years or 7 years of pain to achieve a better forever? I think it's worth it. To my Christian brothers and sisters who are being attacked by the devil, you guys are talking about sleep paralysis and that enemy is coming to you at night and things are getting heavier for you. Praise the Lord God Almighty, that's happening. Praise the Lord. There's a brother on here that's telling you to maybe get a crucifix or open your Bible and that will help you. I'm asking you not to be superstitious, because the Bible doesn't tell me to put my faith in the crucifixes, or doesn't tell me to put my faith in the Bible. It tells me to put my faith in Jesus Christ. If that demon is coming to you in the middle of the night, I would get on my knees and I would fast if I had to, and I would pray, Holy Spirit, is there an open door that is allowing this enemy to come and attack me? Is there a cursed object in my home? Is there movies or books or magazines or clothing that honor the devil that is an open door for them to come and attack me in my sleep? Is there an unconfessed sin? Am I prideful? Lord, I humble myself before you and I ask that you reveal to me, is there an open door that this enemy is coming to attack me? The Lord doesn't care about your superstitions, okay? Christians, please listen to me, all right? Please, please, please. If you are saved, you have the helmet of salvation. If you have faith, you have the shield of faith, okay? I don't need to wake up every morning and put on my shoes and my belt of truth and my shield of faith, okay? Righteousness. The breastplate, that covers your heart, your vital organs. That is the life, right? That is huge. If you are not righteous and you're doing your own thing and you're not following the commandments and you're like, yeah, life is awesome. I look just like the world. You don't have your breastplate of righteousness on. I don't care if you wake up and 10 times a day you say, I put on the breastplate of righteousness. You don't have it. You don't have it. You're being superstitious. There is no difference from you than you throwing salt over your shoulder, or doing the rosary beads, or saying Hail Marys, and doing whatever you want to do. Or like the Muslims, who like to do whatever they want to do and just say, well, I'll just ask for forgiveness during my 5 times of prayer. Stop doing that. Stop being too double-minded. God doesn't care about your superstition. God cares about your heart. Are you humbling yourself? Are you obeying God? Are you looking like the world? That's what God cares about. Please, please, please understand. And if you get on your knees and the Holy Spirit says, no, you are good, you are following the commandments, and you still get attacked, awesome. Praise the Lord. Because God wants to give you more. He's testing you to see if you'll fight, if you will be violent. Will you be violent for the kingdom? Will you know who you are? Will you be violent? So, do you want to follow the commandments? If you do, let's go to Leviticus 26. Verse 8, those who follow the commandments, 5 of you shall chase 100, and 100 of you shall put 10,000 to flight, and your enemies shall fall before you by the sword. Okay? You don't want to follow the commandments. You want to do your own thing. Let's jump down to verse 36. The sound of a shaken leaf shall chase them. and they shall flee, as fleeing from a sword, and they shall fall when none pursueth. Christians, brothers and sisters, if you are sinning and you have turned your back on God, or my non-Christian brothers, you should fear. You should be afraid because you don't have the protection of the Lord. You are punching holes in your hedge. Job 1 to 2, verse 10. You are opening the door. 1 John 5, 8. If you keep yourself, the enemy can't touch you. Have the breastplate of righteousness, okay? By not sinning. Have shield of faith by obeying the commandments and hearing the word of God and saying, enemy, I don't care how big of a devil you are, that Jesus Christ who lives in me created you, created you. Is there a demon that is big enough that Jesus Christ fears? No. He that raised Jesus Christ from the dead now lives in you. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. My Bible doesn't tell me to fear the enemy. My Bible tells me to fear the Lord. Read Psalms 2. It's the Lord we should be afraid of. It's the Lord who's in control. It's the Lord who rules with an iron scepter and smashes the Illuminati and the New World Order into pieces, into pottery pieces. That's the God I serve. That is the God I serve. Praise the Lord, you're being attacked. Here's a suggestion. Devil sitting on your chest, you wake up, you can't say anything. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Say it out loud, right? It starts as a whisper, starts in the mind, starts as a whisper, starts getting louder, louder. Okay, he gets off your chest. Hey, demon, thank you. Oh, you just encouraged me. You just woke up the ambassador of Jesus Christ. And guess what? I'm going to pray in the spirit for 15 minutes until I go back to sleep. I'm going to pray. I'm going to war. I'm going to be violent right now because you just woke me up. You just woke up the sleeping giant. I'm going to pray for the lost right now. I'm going to pray that tomorrow when I get up, I'm going to go and save somebody. I'm going to go and heal somebody. I'm going to be violent because you dared enter my rest and you woke me up and you tried to scare me. I'm not afraid of you. You should be afraid of me because Jesus Christ lives in me and I'm going to be violent. Oh, I love it. I love the battle. For all those Christians who think Christianity, or non-Christian who thinks Christianity is boring, you do not know what you're talking about. If you want to be woken up from the matrix, here's the fight. The fight is on. Let's be violent. Our battle's not against flesh and blood. And those of you Christians who put your faith in chariots and horses and AR-15s and, I feel sorry for you. Because my God doesn't move through those things. We have a host of angelic beings. We have a great cloud of witnesses. We have Jesus Christ. We have the blood of the Lamb. We have God on our side. Who do you have on yours? Fear? Lies? Deceit? Okay. You're a worthy adversary. But if I follow God's commandments and keep myself and keep my hedge, I am a force to be reckoned with. There's no demon that you have in your kingdom that can stop me, that can stop the power of God. Okay? So, if you get sleep paralysis or you're getting attacked, be violent. Please, be violent. Okay? And if you don't believe the same way that I believe, as you notice, I haven't told you what I believe, let me suggest this to you too. We're some smart people. You're smart. I'm smart. Pre-tribbers are smart. Mid-tribbers are smart. Post-tribbers are smart. These are smart people. And they have biblical support for their beliefs. Okay? What's wrong with the words? I don't know. Yeah, I'm just going to put that on the shelf. And I'm going to do the master's business. Okay? When the king goes away, the Bible does say, well, my king tarries, so I'm going to, you know, don't beat the servants and don't get drunk, because the king can come back as a thief in the night. Okay? So if your butt wakes up tomorrow and you're still on this earth, you have a job to do. Okay? Also, the Bible doesn't say, go pitch a tent up on the hill, get a lounge chair, and go wait for the master. Look north, look south, look east, look west. Spend 12 hours a day looking for the King of Kings to come back. It doesn't say that either. You have a job to do. You have a job to do. You need to feed the servants. You need to feed the pigs and the cows and the, not the pigs, obviously, but you have a job to do. You have to clean the house. You have to, you know, be about the business of the master. Amen? Will you stand with me? Can we just say we don't know? We hope. I have a theory. And if that frightens you, I'm sorry. But if some new information comes in, I'm able to say, oh, yeah, that's okay. Yeah, that sounds good. And I'll lean more towards this end. But no way, shape, and form this new information comes in and says, how dare you? I'm a this. I'm a that. You're on the outside of my camp. That is division. And if you're doing that, you are of the devil. You are dividing the kingdom. You are dividing the kingdom. I want you with me. I don't care if you're pre-trib, mid-trib, or post-trib. I need your help. I need you to pick me up. I need you to pray for me. I need us to go out and raise the dead, heal the sick, save souls from fire. Okay? Those people who are going to hell, do they care if you're a pre-trib, mid-trib, pre-wrath, post-trib? Do they? No, they need Jesus. Amen? So stop with the whole division. Stop. That is demonic. Plain and simple. And if you're being attacked by the enemy, Lord, Holy Spirit, is there something that is an open door? I want to rid my life of anything that hinders. Okay, let me leave you with this analogy. Hebrews 12:1. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with such a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight. Lay aside every weight. The sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. You remember when you're a little kid and your best friend wanted to race you to that tree that's about a quarter mile down there? What did you do? You got down, you tied your laces, right? You rolled up your sleeves. You got your keys out of your pocket. If there is lint in your pocket, you would take it out of your pocket because you're thinking it could hinder you. Amen? And then you limbered up. You flexed out. Even if you had an outer shirt, you would take out the outer shirt. Even though it weighed an ounce, you would take it off. You would get ready for the race. I'm telling you that a lot of you guys have demons. And a lot of you guys are just saying, in my heart, I don't feel like I have demons. I don't care what's in your heart. I care what's in the Bible. Okay? I want you to run the race with fullness. And I want you to be violent because those demons are stealing from you. And you need to be violent and take your body back. And take your health back. And take your family back. And take your house back. And take your finances back. Let's be violent. Stop, you know, playing footsies with the devil, okay? He's not a bumblebee. If you mess with him, you know, don't mess with him because he'll mess with you. No, he's here to steal, kill, and destroy you. He wants you to think he's not around. He wants you not to mess with him. Get violent, okay? I don't want to hear about superstition and put a crucifix above your bed. I want you to close the door to the enemy. I want you to get violent, and I want you to take back your right as a child of God, as an ambassador of Jesus Christ. Those demons are afraid of you. I guarantee it. Those demons are afraid of you. They just don't want you to know it. All right? They don't want you to know who you are. Stop watching horror movies. Stop listening to the sermon of the devil. Because if you meditate more on horror movies and rather more on the Word of God, you will believe that the enemy is more powerful than you are. I guarantee it. And that's where you are right now. Let's get violent. Stand beside me. Another thing about your pre-tribbers. Sorry, I don't mean to call you that and put you in a box. To my Christian brothers who believe, who have the idea of pre-tribulation, what about our brothers and sisters in communist China right now? What about our brothers and sisters in every Muslim country across the face of this planet? They're getting stoned. They're getting their heads chopped off right now. They're being beheaded right now. Can I say that it might be American pride that we don't think that that's going to happen to us? What makes us so better than our Christian brothers in China? What makes us better than our Christian brothers in Muslim nations? They're being beheaded and beaten and stoned, and their kids are being ripped apart in front of them. What makes us better than them? There's no rapture for them. They weren't delivered. We need to get rid of our American pride and our European pride and Australian pride or whatever, because we're smarter. We're smarter than those stupid third world country nations. That's a bunch of garbage. You know what those guys got? When they get saved, they have faith right away. And those guys get healed. Because if you tell them, they have faith like little children. But here in America, us smarty pants, man, it will take a miracle of God to have us believe that we can heal the sick. Even though it's a fourth of what Jesus Christ did, we still want to make our awesome theologies and our Hebraic studies and our eschatology and our hermeneutics and our apologetics. And we want to make a theology that takes the balls out of God's scripture. And that's why I said, because we are taking the power out of the gospel. And the Bible's pretty clear about that. Those who have a form of godliness but deny its power, turn away from them. Oh, I love you. Gosh, if you're here, I'd give you a hug, but I want to be your coach right now. I don't want to kick you while you're down. I want to raise you up and say, I need you. I need you in the fight. And I'm asking you not to wait around for Jesus Christ. If your butt is here on the earth, you have a job to do. Please come stand beside me. I don't care what your eschatology views are. I don't even care if your eternal salvation or all that stuff. All that stuff is moot. Like the deity of Jesus Christ, that's what I care about. I'll be dogmatic about that. Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Jesus Christ saved me. That is the only way to be saved. Amen. All that other stuff, yeah, that sounds good. Okay, yeah, good for you. You know, I know that'll get you guys in a hissy, and that's fine. But I'm still asking you to stand beside me. Okay? I've had enough Christians stab me in the back when I'm down on the ground. I need you to stand beside me, pick me up. I'm picking you up. And right now I'm telling you, stop, get rid of those superstitious things, okay? If you are saved, you have the helmet of salvation. If you have faith, you have the shield of faith, okay? Get violent. Whew. Satan is afraid of you, I guarantee it.